I know we've got some people looking at directories back there, but we're going to go ahead and get started. I will promise that by 7:30 each night we will conclude. I'm thinking an hour and 15, hour and 10, hour and 15 minutes is probably about as much study time as any of us really want. Plus, I get to some low before dark, so we will hold to that schedule if that works for you all.
The average 70-year-old attention span is about that. And I say that's our average.
It's interesting, the book that we are basing our study on is, at first was kind of hard to follow because it jumps around based on themes. We're not going to do that in this class. I'm going to introduce a few themes and then we're going to go into it. But I remember, and these words came back to me pretty clearly as I started thinking about how to teach this. My Old Testament professor, Arnold Blackrose, was one of the best Old Testament scholars in the Presbyterian Church, A.B. Rose. He wrote the book, The Mighty Acts of God. Some of you may have remembered reading that. And it was a study course back in the 60s. But it was also our book that we had as for our introduction Old Testament class that I had. A.B. Rhodes was very likely my favorite theology professor. And one of the things he told us at the very beginning is there is no substitute for reading the Bible, especially when you're doing Bible study. You've got to get into the text itself. So I'm going to hold to that. And over the next 4 nights, not only are we going to be looking at the story of Exodus, we're going to be looking at the story of Jacob and Joseph, going back into Genesis after we've done Exodus. This book by David Foreman, who is a rabbi and is also a professor of Hebrew studies at Johns Hopkins University. He is profoundly insightful. And I think bringing his knowledge of Hebrew to the text, he translates things a little bit differently in some places, and we're going to look at those differently than what we see written in the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible, or even in RSV or some other versions of the Bible. His interpretation, for example, we always hear about Pharaoh hardening his heart. There are actually two different Hebrew words that are being used there. He makes a distinction about those two Hebrew words that suddenly transforms it for me. I remember as a student, and over the years going back, never have I seen the role of free will as it applies to Pharaoh before reading this book. It's profound. And the implications of that then for our understanding of our faith as Christians also helps to reinforce for me, and I think for us as Presbyterians, foundational beliefs about what we hold true to be about God. So we're going to be looking at a lot of those things. But what he does, essentially, I'm going to give you just a thumbnail sketch and then we'll open with prayer. What he does here between these two stories of the story of Pharaoh and Moses and the story of Pharaoh and Joseph, which happens about 230 years before the story of the Exodus story, when Joseph was in prison and then got out. To realize they are in some ways, telling the same story from two different perspectives was truly, truly profound and insightful. I never saw that before. Now that he builds a case, and he does it very well, Foreman is an excellent biblical scholar. We may not agree with 100% of what he says, but he makes such a compelling argument that you can't ignore what he says. So as we go into this, everything we've learned about the Exodus story is going to be strengthened and then further insight given to you, I'm sure, because I've just never heard it talk this way before. Let us open with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we are ever thankful. We thank you for this time of vacation Bible school in which we as adults can study your word and find new depth and meaning. We thank you for Rabbi David Foreman, who opens the Old Testament and the Hebrew text to help to illumine to us what truly is there. We ask, O Lord, your blessing of insight and guidance to be with each of us this evening. We also pray your blessing upon our fellowship time. As we study together, may we grow together. And as we grow together, may we grow more as in the image of Christ together. We ask these things in confidence. We give you thanks for the turnout of 28 children today for our first day of vacation Bible school, and are excited about that. And we thank you for the efforts of so many who've made the vacation Bible school experience for the children to be exciting and inviting. We pray that they are blessed also from this time. So we offer these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. As we think then about the translation of the Hebrew, I want to start out with some concepts, and then we're going to go right into the text itself. Two phrases, korban pesach, which is on your handout here, is the term for the Passover meal, or the tradition of Passover. It is absolutely central. It's a central concept to understanding the role of Exodus. Because what happens at the Pesach is this identification of a response of the people of God to God. What we see in this text, and really I think what Foreman points out so very clearly, is this whole text is a battle between monotheism and polytheism. By polytheism, multiple gods. And certainly the most powerful nation in the world in its day and time was polytheistic. What does that mean? Basically, polytheistic religion was that there was a god of the waters, and there was a god of the sun, and there was a god of this, that, and the other, and everything had a god. So you had competing powers, competition between the different gods. So how do you influence those gods? Well, you do all kinds of things to keep them from being angry. Or you do things that you think are going to manipulate the gods to do your bidding. Especially when it comes to growing crops and agriculture, that was a primary theme and focus. And certainly, in the Egyptian culture, the Pharaoh was identified as a living god. So here he is, one god of many in a pantheism, many gods, or a world of gods, pantheism, you have this notion that God, the god Pharaoh, is, in this text, up against the God of Israel. How are we going to work out that problem? Because it's going to be a showdown. And so we're going to see how that becomes a showdown. Korban Pesach is the Passover meal, the festival of a relationship between God and God's people. And we remember what happened was they were told, the 10th plague, they were told, put some blood of an animal on top of the lintel, on the sides, lintels of your door, on the top of the door. So they do that. And the Spirit of God, which comes from the angel of death, comes through, and where the angel sees those markings, then he passes over the household. Interesting that they would come up with the idea of Passover as a way to talk about the freedom. But that's exactly what happens here. Is this is an establishment of the beginning of a relationship of freedom. The people of Israel were being freed from the power of slavery, and the Pharaoh had enslaved them after so many years. And so the Passover is their prescribed response. Here's how God wants them to respond to God. By remembering. You know, you think about the word there, do this in remembrance. So remembering is a part of our heritage too, our religious heritage as Christians. And you will see parallels of ideas between the Old Testament that go all the way back to the Passover and the Paschal Lamb. Who is our Paschal Lamb? Jesus Christ, the sacrifice. He's the firstborn. And so a lamb to be sacrificed could only be a year old, but was to be pure. And so we see these overlays of theology and ideas about a relationship with God that go all the way back to the founding of God's people. Certainly, it goes back even farther than that. God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And we see that phrase over and over in the story of Exodus, too. This reminder to them that they are of a lineage. And essentially what God is saying is, I know your people. I've had this relationship with you for lots of years. I know your great-granddaddy and your granddaddy and your daddy, and now you're here. And so this idea of a relationship with the monotheistic God is what plays out in this. Notice here also, everything about the Passover, the spreading of blood of an animal on the lintels and doorposts of the Hebrew people, so the angel of death will not visit. Everything about it speaks of oneness, one animal slaughtered who is 1 year old. Those who meet are a single group, one family or a family with their guests. That's how the Passover is celebrated. And what happens during that Passover? The youngest child asks the question, why are we here? And the oldest one, who was in there, tells the story of the Passover. So you have this notion of firstborn, or the oldest one, who was acting as the firstborn, to communicate to the next generation what the history is. And that is played out in this. No bones of the animal are broken. Christ on the cross did not have a broken bone in his body. That's the way. Must be roasted so the meat stays intact rather than boiled. It had to be together, one whole. Even eating the meal in a paste, misspelled that word, signifies that a narrow time period of this celebration as close to a single point in time as possible. That it was a rushed meal. They had to eat and run. So we know that also with the kind of bread that they had. It was unleavened bread. Just bake it and put it out there like a tortilla, only a Middle Eastern tortilla. The Korban Pesach was a oneness offering. Right now, a new term, bakor. The bakor is a term for firstborn. And the firstborn has a very important role to play in a Hebrew family. It's a status brought with it that it's brought also with status, special rights. And this person who is the baker of a family, the firstborn, receives a double portion. Every other child receives a single portion of an inheritance that's equal to everyone else's. The bankor receives a double portion. But the bankor also has a responsibility to pass on the values of the previous generation to his kinfolk and the generation yet to come. So the bankor has a big responsibility to teach the values and the expectations. There is a term that's used in here in the book called bankorot, which is the plural of bankor. And speaking of the firstborn males of the Egyptians, Egypt's bankorot were all of the firstborn males in the different families. Why is that important? We're going to certainly explore that in our text, but essentially, if we will start out in the text, and the text takes us to a point where we see that the Pharaoh has pronounced that all male children of the Hebrews shall be killed because they're spreading too fast. And so this understanding of bankorot is not something that God says, I'm going to punish them by killing all their firstborn males. This is already something that has happened in reverse to the Hebrew people. The bankor can be both an individual within a family, or in the case of Israel, it's the entire people. Israel as the bankor. So Israel has been given a double portion of God's blessing, but has a responsibility that goes with that, of being, of helping the rest of the nations of the world to see that God is a monotheistic God and desires a relationship. And so their responsibility as the Bekor nation is that they are to live out this responsibility of devotion and allegiance to God and God alone. And we realize over and over again as we move further into both the story of Exodus, but even on into the king period of 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings, we see where they get into trouble whenever they fall away from their responsibility of being a bankor nation. And they do that by worshiping other gods. So, we're going to look at, I'd like for us to start out with reading Exodus 1-3, and then we'll start looking at the particulars of this. I'm going to ask for some help if some of you who would be willing to read, and I will stop you as we go, because there are points to be made all along the way through this, and that's the value of what we're going to be doing. We'll take two evenings to go through about 14 chapters. Then we're going to go back to the story of Genesis and the story of Jacob and Joseph in Genesis. So tonight, though, notice here in chapter 1, at the very beginning, we are being introduced to something that was heavily dealt with in Genesis towards the end of the book of Genesis. And that's the names of the sons of Jacob. Notice also here that Jacob, and we'll see this introduced first in Genesis, but the name Jacob is interplayed with the name Israel over and over. So the sons of Israel here are really the sons of Jacob. But the writer intends for us to have both the person Jacob and the nation of Israel in our mind at the same time, which is why that term is interplayed here, Jacob, Israel. And here at the very beginning, we see that. These are the names of the sons of Israel, Jacob, who came to Egypt with Jacob, each with his household: Reuben, Simeon, Levi, and Judah; Issachar, Zebulun, and Benjamin; Dan, Naphtali, Gad, and Asher. The total number of people born to Jacob was 70. Joseph was already in Egypt. Then Joseph died, and all his brothers in that whole generation. But the Israelites were fruitful and prolific, They multiplied and grew exceedingly strong, so that the land was filled with them. So here we have, as the introduction into Egypt, the population of Jacob's sons and their families who come down here to Egypt. And there are 11 sons in addition to Joseph. Joseph is already there, so he's named afterwards, but there are 11 sons along with Joseph. So we get the idea of the 12 tribes of Israel coming out of this. And keep that in mind as we continue to read this. David, if you don't mind reading from 8 until we get up here to about 16, and then I'll stop there and we'll talk about what we see.
Now, a new king arose over Egypt, who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and the Ram cities for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shiphrah and the other Pua, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, heal him, but if it is a girl, she shall live."
Okay. So there we have this idea of healing the male Hebrew people being introduced. It is a command by a Pharaoh who is not nearly as favorable towards the people of Israel as the Pharaoh of Joseph's time. Now, how much time is in between these two? Around 210 years. So we're talking 6-7 generations past the time of Joseph. So much so that all of this 12 sons and their families had multiplied to the extent that they outnumber the Egyptians, or at least the Egyptians in charge. And that is a great threat to the nation of Egypt. Back in the time of Joseph, Pharaoh was so favorable to Joseph that not only did he call him a son and give him great wealth and prosperity, he also gave him one of the best places in the land of Egypt, Goshen. And so the Israelites settle in the land of Goshen, and they become so populous that they become a major threat to Pharaoh himself. And Pharaoh's decree in response to that popularity is to make sure that all the male children are to be killed. But here's an act of civil disobedience in the midst of this. It's done by two women, Shiphrah and Pua. And their disobedience is to not kill. We'll read on there. Would you continue with verse 16 then?
But the midwives feared God, and they did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this and allowed the boys to live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Egyptian women are not like the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live."
Okay. So now there's even greater clarity to this Throw them in the nine, all these boys. Simple disobedience on the act on the part of these two women. And God looks favorably upon that. God is actively involved with the Hebrew people here in the first chapter. Very much a part of this process by helping to make sure that the Hebrew boys that are born still live. John, would you read chapter 2 for us?
Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine boy, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch, and she put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe in the river, and while her attendants walked beside the river, she saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. And his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I'll give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses because she said, "I drew him out of the water."
In this stuff right here. Isn't it interesting? Throw those boys into the Nile. Well, he was in the Nile. They had done pretty much what he had commanded. Only he was in the basket and able to be saved. And isn't it interesting? Again, civil disobedience to these Hebrew people. It is his sister who happens to be standing watching, making sure that this baby of Moses is going to be safe. But she happens to be standing there and probably knew that the Pharaoh's daughter would be coming down to this particular place to bathe. So that's where she put baby Moses in the Nile, according to the command of Pharaoh. And when she sees the mother of Pharaoh's daughter, she says, "Would you mind for me to get a wet nurse for the baby?" "Yeah, that'd be great. And I'll pay her. I will pay the mother to raise the baby." Isn't that something? Yeah, pay the mother to be the mother. So here we have, it's interesting how the hand of God works in this situation, and Moses is named by who? Pharaoh's daughter. That's who gives Moses his name. This is an Egyptian name for Moses. So let's move on from there. Please to Midian. John, if you'll continue to the end of verse 2, chapter 2.
Now one day after Moses had grown up, he went out to his people and saw their forced labor. He saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his kinfolk. He looked this way and that, seeing no one. He killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. When he went out the next day, he saw two Hebrews fighting, and he said to the one who was in the wrong, "Why do you strike your fellow Hebrew?" And he answered, "Who made you a ruler and judge over us? Do you mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian?" Then Moses was afraid and thought, "Surely the thing is known." When Pharaoh heard of it, he sought to kill Moses. But Moses fled from Pharaoh. He settled in the land of Midian and sat down by a well. The priest of Midian had 7 daughters. They came to draw water and filled the troughs to water their father's flock. But some shepherds came and drove them away. Moses got up and came to their defense and watered their flock. When they returned to their father, Raoul, he said, "How is it that you have come back so soon?"
So it's interesting, when we go back to the very first verse of chapter 2, a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The Levite tribe was what?
Priestly.
Priestly tribe. So Moses is of the priestly tribe of the Hebrews, even though he is named by the Egyptian. But having been raised by his own mother, he had a different eye towards what was going on in Egypt. He was an outsider in that land, and he realized that when his one of his people were killed by an Egyptian, that's when he acted. So Moses is a wanted criminal. He's a murderer. He goes to the land of Midian, and he helps the priest of Midian by tending to the seven daughters that come to the well and providing for their food or for their water and for their daily ritual. What happens there is when they go back, here comes that whole idea of biblical hospitality. Why didn't you invite me? That was just to be expected. If someone does something kind for you on the road, then invite them to be part of our family for a period of time. And he impresses the Midian priest so much that he receives this priest's daughter in marriage. Now we know him later, his name is Jethro, but here he's introduced as Reuel. Let me go into again. Here we keep coming back to this God of Abraham, Isaac, and Joseph, and Jacob. This reminder that this is a relationship with this God that's different from gods who are gods of power in a pantheistic or polytheistic world. So we are here at the burning bush. This is where we're going to start with this text, and then when we get to the actual verse 13 and 14, we're going to go back to looking at our handout together a bit. So, Marilyn, would you read 3 through verse 14 for us?
Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burnt up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them.
So now, if you look at the middle of your page there, Exodus 3:13, the name that is given on four syllables, or consonants, Yahweh, Y-H-V-H, or Y-H-W-H. In these letters, you find the root in Hebrew of past, present, and future. Now, they're not all the same, but in those four consonants, you find the roots of the words was, is, and is to come, or shall be. All of those are found there. So how do we interpret this name of God? Up until this time, God has been impersonal. He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's the God of your ancestors. But now Moses wants to know, who's sending you? What do I tell them? So here's the personal name that God identifies for himself. And it means, I will be who I will be. I am who I am. I will create what I will create. I will become that which I will become. Or I will bring into being that which I bring into being. What does all that mean? Past, present, and future bound up into one identity. And one who we never really see face to face. In the burning bush story, Moses gets a glimpse of God's back. We see that, I think, a little later on in the story. But never face on or in the future. And rarely when God reveals himself in the present, here what he does, he shows himself in his back, which means we can see where God was a lot easier than we can see God present before us. Why is that? How do you define God who is outside of time? That's what this does. It is trying to convey to us that God is outside the realm of what we know in this world. God is past, present, and future. God creates. God is the creator. I will create what I will create. This notion of it is infinity in as tangible a form as God can communicate to humanity. That's what's being told in this understanding. Those moments in the present with God are transcendent moments of God, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I know your past, and these are your parents. We go a long way back. All of that is part of this. Now, we're going to look at Exodus, jump over a minute, and look at Exodus 6, 2, and 3. Because here again we're dealing with a name or an identity of God. And the Lord said to Moses, now you shall see what I will do to Pharaoh. Indeed, by a mighty hand he will let them go. By a mighty hand he will drive them out of his land. This is speaking about God's mighty hand. God also spoke to Moses and said, I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham and Jacob and Isaac as God Almighty by my name. God Almighty. So there we have another name. Now we're talking about the name Elohim. El literally means power. So, God defines, according to the relationship that we see with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, one way to understand who God is God is power. But so are the pantheistic gods of Egypt, power. So to define God only as God Almighty, God Power, is only defining in terms of what the Egyptians also believe. And that's not going to sway the Egyptians to think about God, because they already realize gods as gods, plural, as power. So here in this, the second commandment, you shall have no other God before me. You shall have no other power, Elohim, before me. And for us as we think of God who says you shall have no other gods, a Baal or a Hercules or some other god in the realm of all these gods. But what really is being said there is you shall have no other power before me. Now that makes it a little bit harder to follow because there are other powers in each of our lives that we go to and that we adhere to. So it's a challenge to understand this notion of Elohim as being powerful. So the term El Shaddai is the exact term God Almighty. God has power enough to establish limits over creation. El Shaddai is a God who establishes limits. So, if creation were to keep on creating, it would be chaos. But what God does here, as El Shaddai, is establish boundaries and limits. And what I want to suggest to you at this point, where we'll figure out how this plays out, is that one of the limits that God puts out there is a self-limit. Self-limiting power. Why would God self-limit? There's this thing called free will. And if free will is an expression, and if God truly loves humanity and expects a free response that's not coerced or manipulated, it's got to be given away. So this notion of free will helps us to begin to think that our God is self-limited, puts limitations on what he's willing to do at any point in time. One of the great ways that the text brings out about this notion of a self-limiting God is how come God just didn't throw in a magic carpet and get all the Hebrew people on it and fly them off to their land of promise? Why do we engage in all of this gobbledygook of stuff that goes on? It's so complex. Complex. We're going to look at how God limits his own power as we look at these plagues. We're going to go another 25 minutes, and I know we're only going to be scratching the surface, but we've got 2 nights for this, so we're good. We're good on our time. But keep in mind, this notion of El Shaddai is an interpretation of God who sets limits on creation, and including, I believe, limits on himself, on God. I want to read out of the book, page 54 and 55. If you've got the book with you, you don't have to have it to hear this, but this is a great little story. It's based on Monopoly, so anybody who's ever played Monopoly knows where this is going. 54 and 55. It's called Little Hat and Little Shoe Go for a Walk. A few years back, I was having a conversation with a friend of mine who was proudly considered himself as an atheist. He was making one of his favorite points, where is God, I wanted to know. If God really exists, how come you and I don't see more of him? I told him he reminded me of Little Hat and Little Shoe, wondering about the whereabouts of Parker. I was referring, of course, to tokens on Monopoly, the real estate trading game made by Parker Brothers. If you've ever played the game, you know that there are all sorts of tokens by which a player can choose to represent him or herself. You can be the automobile, the thimble, the little hat, the little shoe, and today there's all kinds of other things you can add to that. Imagine the discussion between Little Hat and Little Shoe, who are faithfully going around the Monopoly board for the umpteenth time. As Little Hat passes a hotel belonging to one of his opponents, he says to Little Shoe, say, do you believe in Parker? Little Shoe looks at him quizzically. Little Hat exclaims, you know, look over there on the side of the board. It says in big black letters, made by Parker Brothers. So do you believe in that? Do you believe in Parker? Little she replies, yes, I suppose I do, but what about you? Little Hat responds with an air of weary frustration. Look, I've been around here a long time. Every week I pass Joe, I collect my $200. I've been to Tennessee Avenue, St. James Place, Boardwalk, you name it. I've seen it all. Heck, I've even been to jail. And I'll tell you something, I ain't never seen Parker. This whole time, I've just never bumped into him. So no, I don't believe in Parker. I'm a Parker atheist. If you could interject at this point in the conversation, what would you say to Little Hat? You'd say, my dear Little Hat, you're looking for Parker in all the wrong places. Parker doesn't live on the board. He made the board. The maker of a system doesn't live inside the system. As a creator, you can interact with the system you made. You can make the rules by which it functions. You can decree that every piece collects 200 on passing go, and that when a player picks a chance card that says go directly to jail, then yes, that player really has to go to jail. All that a creator can do. But the creator doesn't live on the board. That's not his natural place. The board is the environment put in place for the created, not the creator. In the case of humankind, the board is the universe, the world of space and time in which we find ourselves. When we look around the universe demanding to touch, feel, or see the creator, we are looking in the wrong place. We are treating the creator as if he were one of us. The universe is a place made for creatures. It's not the natural domicile. Isn't that good? So next time somebody raises Cain with you, ask them if they believe in Parker. So here we have this notion of a self-limiting God, and we have a God who clearly is outside of the known creation itself, yet who wants a relationship with the creation itself. And that's at work in the story over and over. The difference between worshiping in a polytheistic theological realm of many gods and a monotheistic realm of one God. If your understanding of gods is different powers, so that you decide one day we need to pray to the God of rain because we need rain in the valleys. So we're going to do everything we can to manipulate that God. But there are other gods. There's the God of sun. And the God of sun is also a power and in conflict with the God of rain. And you have the God of the earth. And so it was a constant process of trying to manipulate and control this polytheistic understanding of gods in Egypt. And you have that orientation come up and slam heads against this notion of a single God who is power over all of those other elements. And that is crucial. That understanding of the difference between polytheism and monotheism as being at work in this text is so crucial to understanding what's going on in this text. It's absolutely essential. What do you give to God in worship? What do you give to a God who has everything? Well, relationship of trust, the Shema in Deuteronomy 6:4. Really clarifies that for us. And it goes this way. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. So what God, the monotheistic God, is asking for as a response from the people is a relationship of devotion, a relationship based on love. Yes, John.
Yeah. The polytheists, the Egyptians, they certainly didn't love gods.
No.
They were probably
Because of love, and because love has to be totally self-giving and not coerced, the role of free will, we're back at that again. So all human beings, including Frederick, has to have autonomy of free will in his decision making as he's relating to God's people. That complicates things. That's more than a magic carpet ride out of Egypt. That means that God, what essentially we see in the book of Exodus is that there are two primary goals. The first goal is God is going to free the Israelites because they are oppressed by slavery. The second goal, which is equally at play in this text, is that God is going to encourage Pharaoh and the Egyptians to understand a monotheistic God and to accept and follow that monotheistic God rather than consider Pharaoh to be a god amongst many in their culture. So that's a big order, a tall order for God to fill on this study. But that's what's at work here. Let's go back to Exodus 3:16 following. Go and assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, has appeared to me, saying, I have given heed to you and to what has been done to you in Egypt. So where does Moses now is appealing to, or is being told by God to go and appeal to his own people. And he's told to do so with the name they know. Remind them, I've known you people a long time. I love you people a long time. I've served you people a long time. I am the God of your ancestors. I will declare that I will bring you out of the misery of Egypt to the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, the land flowing with milk and honey. They will listen to your voice, and you and the elders of Israel shall go to the king of Egypt and say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Let us now go 3 days' journey into the wilderness so that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God. I know, however, that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless compelled by a mighty hand. All right. God knows that Pharaoh is stubborn. But God is going to try the least challenging to Egypt and try to reason with Pharaoh. Go and tell him, he says, to let my people go just for 3 days. Why just for 3 days? If you're going out so you can go out and worship God in the wilderness only for 3 days, it's a testimony. If Pharaoh will agree to this, then there's some room in play in how God relates to Pharaoh in bringing them to an understanding of releasing the Israelites. So this is a test run. God is trying to give Pharaoh every opportunity to say yes. I know, however, that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless compelled by a mighty hand. So I will stretch out my hand and strike Egypt with all my wonders that I will perform in it. After that, he will let you go. I will bring this people into such favor with the Egyptians that when you go, you will not go empty-handed. Look at this. Each woman shall ask her neighbor and any woman living in the neighbor's house for jewelry or silver and gold. Clothing, and you shall put them on your sons and on your daughters, and so you shall plunder the Egyptians. Now, I've read that story 100 times, and I don't think I really paid attention to the fact that not only is it God's intention that the Hebrew people be free, but that they're going to take with them, they're going to willingly give them their silver and gold as they head out of the fort. How does that happen?
Truly chosen people, I guess.
Yeah. Moses' miraculous power. Then Moses answered, but suppose they do not believe me or listen to me, but say, the Lord did not appear to you. The Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? He said, a staff. And he said, throw it on the ground. So he threw the staff on the ground, and it became a snake. And Moses drew back from it. If you remember, one of the images of salvation in the Old Testament is the staff of Moses that turns into a snake. How is it that a snake is an image of salvation? We just read it. It's that by God revealing himself to the Hebrews, by turning a staff into a snake, is a way of revealing the presence of God in their lives and the one who brings salvation to them. So he threw the staff on the ground, and it became a snake, and Moses drew back. Then the Lord said to Moses, reach out your hand and seize it by the tail. So he reached out his hand and grasped it, and it became a staff in his hand, so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their ancestors, again, how many times do we hear this? The God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and all these, has appeared to you. Again, the Lord said to him, put your hand inside your cloak. He put his hand in his cloak, and then he put it out, and it was leprous as white as snow. Then God said, put your hand back in your cloak. So he put his hand back in his cloak, and when he took it out, it was restored like the rest of his body. If they will not believe you or heed the first sign, they may heed the second sign. If they did not believe even these two signs or heed you, you shall take some water from the Nile and pour it on the dry ground, and the water that you shall take from the Nile will become blood on the dry ground. But Moses said to the Lord, oh my Lord, I have never been eloquent. Moses is doing everything he can to get out of jail. I'm not eloquent, I can't do this. What do you mean? Call on somebody else. But I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. Then the Lord said to him, who gives speech to mortals? Who makes them mute or deaf, seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, and I will be with your mouth and teach you what you are to speak. But he said, oh, my Lord, will you send someone else? Who is Moses to be talking back to God like this? Send somebody else. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses, and he said, what of your brother Aaron the Levite? I know that he can speak fluently. Even now he is coming out to meet you. And when he sees you, his heart will be glad. You shall speak to him and put the words in his mouth, and I will be with your mouth and with his mouth, and will teach you what you shall do. He indeed shall speak for you to the people. He shall serve as a mouth for you, and you shall serve as God. You shall serve as God for him. Take in your hand this staff, which will you shall perform the signs. So, all of this is reasons for trying to convince God he's the wrong man for the job. God has a counter. Surprise, surprise. And God provides him what he needs by providing him with his brother. So he returns to Egypt. Now here's interesting. What we see here in this encounter. Moses went back to his father-in-law Jethro and said to him, please let me go to my kindred in Egypt and see whether they are still living. Jethro said to Moses, go in peace. The Lord said to Moses in Midian, go back to Egypt, for all those who were seeking your life are dead. So Moses took his wife and his sons, put them on a donkey, and went back to the land of Egypt. And Moses carried the staff of God in his hand. Where else do we recognize of putting wife and son on the back of a donkey to go to Egypt? Yeah. So here we have it in Moses. And the Lord said to Moses, when you go back to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders that I have put in your power. But I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go. Then you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my firstborn child, the baker. Here we are. A nation identified as a firstborn child. An entire nation. I said to you, let my son go that he may worship me. But you refuse to let him go. Now I will kill your firstborn son. All right. So this is, if you will, a threat. Jonah and Nineveh. Jonah is hell-bent to leather to destroy the city of Nineveh. But what happens? What happens to that story, Elsie?
Well, God relents and lets the Ninevites live because they repent.
All right.
It makes Jonah
really ticked off at God. Because the people do exactly what God wants them to do. So this is, if you will, a threat similar to that which happened with Nineveh. In that, if you don't do this, Pharaoh, this is what's going to happen. The end result will be the death of your firstborn sons. But there's still, and we will see over and over as we look into this, particularly tomorrow, as we go through all 10 of the plagues, we will see over and over again God giving Pharaoh a chance to turn. Here's, if you will, there's a plan A, a plan B, and a plan C in this. And the plan A is that God can reason with Pharaoh and get Pharaoh to change his ways and agree to let the Israelites go. Now that's plan A. Plan B is, if they won't let you go, then I'll put some pressure on them until they do let you go. But at some point along the way, plan C kicks in, and that is when Pharaoh's heart is so focused on destroying the Israelites or keeping them in slavery so he can retain total control over them, that plan A and plan B, that the urging of God to bring about this change in Pharaoh by increasing the pressure a little bit at a time through these plagues, which we're going to see tomorrow night, that fails to happen. And it is the seventh plague when we see plan C kick into place. And we're going to look at that then tomorrow. But here we see the threat, the initial threat being made. If you follow your plan out to the nth degree, Pharaoh, here's what's going to happen. You're going to lose your firstborn. Now, having heard that, I'll give you some options. Let's see what you do. And Pharaoh continues to stay true to his own image and vision. And so we go back into the text. Chapter 4, verse 24. On the way, at a place where they spent the night, the Lord met him and tried to kill him. But Zipporah took a flint and cut off her son's foreskin and touched Moses' feet with it and said, "Truly, you are a bridegroom of love to me." So he let him alone. It was then, she said, a bridegroom of love by circumcision. The Lord said to Aaron, "Go into the wilderness to meet Moses." So he went, and he met him at the mountain of God and kissed him. Moses told Aaron all the words of the Lord with which he had sent him and all the signs with which he had charged him. Then Moses and Aaron went and assembled all the elders of the Israelites. Aaron spoke all the words that the Lord had spoken to Moses and performed the signs in the sight of the people. The people believed, and when they heard that the Lord had given heed to the Israelites and that he had seen their misery, they bowed down and worshipped. However, afterwards, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and said, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, let my people go, so that they may celebrate the festival for me in the wilderness." Okay, so there are two parallel requests being made to Pharaoh. This is the first one. Let them celebrate with me a festival in the wilderness. This is God's celebration. Then Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should have heed him and let him go? I do not know the Lord, and I will not let Israel go." Then they come up with a second presentation to Pharaoh. They say this: "The God of the Hebrews has revealed himself to us. Let us go a 3 days' journey into the wilderness to sacrifice to the Lord our God, or he will fall upon us with difference between those two. One is to celebrate with God in the wilderness. The second one, after Pharaoh says, ain't no way, you're not going anywhere, the second one is, wait a minute, this God demands sacrifice, and will either that or else he will be angry and kill us with pestilence and sword. What Moses is trying to do is to appeal to Pharaoh's understanding of a God of power in the second. So you have, what does a God of power do? It's going to put down lightning bolts and thunder and divine wrath and kill people. And Moses is trying to appeal to the sensibility and the mindset of Pharaoh, this polytheistic understanding of God, a God who will kill and maim, a God of power. So that's what you see in that second presentation to Pharaoh, is appealing to Pharaoh's own understanding of who God is, or a God is. If we don't let our people go and sacrifice to our God like you sacrifice to your gods, then we're going to be destroyed by our God. But that's not who God was. We saw who God was in that first revelation. A God who wants them to go out and celebrate and be one with God. Now still, at this point, the request is for a three-day journey, like a three-hour cruise on Gilligan's Island. This ends up being a huge ordeal. Tomorrow we're going to get into the 10 plagues, but I'm going to stop there tonight. If you got time for a couple of questions, if there are any questions.
Is there any significance between the use of the verse, the question you just read? Verse 1, God says, the God of Israel, and then when Moses is given this response to Pharaoh, he says, the God of the Hebrews. That the difference between Israelites and Hebrews, is there a difference?
Yeah. Okay, what's behind that? Who was the name Israel? Jacob. So there is a relationship that is a personal relationship between Israel, Jacob, and his clan. And then the God of the wandering people, the Hebrews, the Habelu, are the wandering people. Less personal. So in trying to appeal to Pharaoh, who worships impersonal gods, you don't talk about the God of Israel, the God who is relationship with gods and the people. You talk about a God of these wandering people.
Is it possible, too, that the Hebrews is a larger group than just the descendants of Israel? I mean, is it possible that who went out of Egypt was not just the descendants of Israel, but also some other people called Hebrews?
Well, the term Habelu is really talking about wandering nomads. You could look at, for example, Abraham, who was the father of Ishmael, and the Ishmaelites are people who have settled into the land of Canaan. Probably the Habiru. Then you've got the son of Noah, Shem, who is the father of the Canaanites. So you've got relatives, blood relatives of Jacob and his tribe, who are also there in Canaan. justification for calling all of those tribes the beautiful, the wandering people. Well,